Hey, welcome back to prolongfieldcare.org. I'm Paul. This is going to be a re-record of the initial presentation. I'm going to try to make it a little quicker, and hopefully the audio is a little better as I have a new microphone, as you can tell. We need to improve our far forward medicine by medics by taking upstairs aggressive ICU style medicine around the world anywhere we go. I think we can do a better job, and I think most people agree with me. So here are some of my tips and lessons learned for using documentation to make your life better and your patient's life better in a prolonged field care situation. So I hope to add a few things to your toolbox, and I'll go ahead and get started right now. Before you go, make sure you have a checklist. Make sure you have your meds ready, your fresh whole blood kits, and your blood typing cards done and ready to go. Make sure you have enough fluids. All your specialty equipment is there with your power supply and cables. Make sure your oxygen bottles are filled and your team is familiarized, trained, and practiced in both tactical medicine and prolonged field care. Make sure that you have your telemed planned and practiced and you know who you're going to call and what you're going to call for. Make sure you have multiple evac platforms planned for, and you can go ahead and reference the planning tool on prolongfieldcare.org. This is the 10 Essential Prolonged Field Care's Capabilities Worksheet. So it shows you what you should have in your ruck, in your truck, in your team house, and then what you should take on the plane with you. And it lays it out in a nice, simple, minimum, better, best format. So if you look at, let's say, resuscitation, your minimum thing that you're going to need is a fresh whole blood kit so that you can do a buddy transfusion. Other things, you should have 2 to 3 cases of lactated ringers for burns. And you should also have, at some point in your evac chain, try to identify where those blood products are going to be at if you're going to contact a surgical team or if you're going to wait until you get back to definitive care. All right, once you get to where you're going on your deployment, make sure your meds are locked up and you guys don't have access to those, because nothing worse than getting into your drug box and figuring out that somebody already took everything out of there. Make sure your fresh whole blood kits and your fluids are distributed onto the trucks or other platforms that you have available, and that your specialty equipment is also in the right platform. Make sure that your power supply and cables are ready and out. Make sure that your oxygen is hooked up and wherever you're going to be using it, that it's accessible. Have your team walk through the placement of each bag and the layout of each all the equipment in the bag. Make sure the layout of your aid station is exactly how you would want it to be. Go ahead and rehearse a couple different casualties on your downtime and that your team knows how to help you out. This now is the time to make sure that whatever cell phone or sat phone that you have, whatever radios, reach out to the right people when you need it, because you don't want to find out in a crisis situation that those phone numbers that you have are wrong. All right, so let's get into the documentation. This is something that a nurse wrote down. Obviously, it's a little bit sloppy, but it's okay because this is what helps her get through one small shift. This is one snapshot of what's going on with that one patient at that point in time. So it's not something that you're going to trend vitals with, but it's something that we can all sympathize with. I know I've seen a lot of medics writing down their vitals on pieces of tape when casualty cards or other things are not available, or once their casualty card is filled up. Here's another one with 4 patients. Again, it's a snapshot in time of those 4 patients. So what ICU nurses have done is they've taken all the info that they're going to need and they've laid it out for themselves in what's called a brain sheet, and that's what we're going to go ahead and steal from and show you how to use that in a prolonged field care situation. Some places, I know VCU has a bunch of sheets like this for each individual type of patient that comes through, and they just pull it out of the rack and they fill it out. These are available online if you look for certain kind of patients. So if you think you're going to need something like that, go ahead and get it, but I'll show you something that works even better. This is going to show you what medications people are going to be getting and then how to trend that. So you're going to have on this sheet especially, there's 31 hours, and you can trend what the patient's getting, and you could probably put vitals in there too, but it's not really meant for that. This, however, is. This is a critical care flow sheet that we need to start getting used to using. As you can see where that red bubble just went up, you can track your blood pressure and your heart rate just by putting little symbols on this graph. This is something that some of you old guys may remember. That's the field medical card. That's what it looked like, and you had to fill out specific boxes in order to pass your basic first aid or first responder. Well, now what we're using is a T-Tri-C card. Here's the original 2007 version that the Rangers came out with. And here is the new one that everybody should be using. This is what should be in your IFAC. But if you look down at the bottom left corner of this thing, it only allows you four different times to put in vitals. So that's not going to get you very far, especially if you have a critically ill patient who you're taking vitals every 5 minutes. That's 5 minutes, because that's going to be about a 20-minute card. At most, if you're doing every 15 minutes, that's going to be a one-hour card. So after an hour, you have to think, what are you going to do? Well, I got to first point out that teams who do use some kind of casualty card, whether it be a piece of tape initially and then a casualty card as you go, are going to be far more efficient, as you're not going to duplicate your efforts. You're not going to come up to a patient, do a treatment, and run away, and then your buddy comes up to that same patient with no documentation and does that same treatment, then he goes away. So you're going to have overdoses on pain meds are going to be less likely, because it's going to be documented and attached to that patient. Yep, so here's the flow sheet that you all should be fairly familiar with. It takes you through a couple hours with a casualty. I think this one goes out to about 4 hours if you're doing it every 15 or 20 minutes. But what it doesn't help is it doesn't help you to interpret what's going on quickly and under stress. So what we've decided to do is develop a prolonged field care casualty card. You're going to notice a lot of similarities, but you're also going to notice differences. So here in the top, you have your admin stuff like you always would. You have your allergies and your missed report right here on the left side. And then you have your little drawing of your guy or your homunculus, where you can start drawing in what's going on with him, the problems, and then you can start putting in your plans for that patient. In the top right, you have your TQ time on and the time converted, because you know you have to get this done within the first 4 hours. Your drugs and fluid administered, just like the other card, but now we get into a telemed call script, and it tells you a little fill in the blanks, what's going on with your patient, and then what that person provider told you to do and their recommendations. At some point, you can put standing orders. You can either get those from the doc that you called, or you can make these up yourself so that this is visible for all the other team members for to see and do for your patient, whether it's normal vital signs or nursing care. And we have some of those nursing care things straight out of the SoftMed handbook in the very bottom right of page one. So you, here you have side two, or the back side of the PFC casualty card. Across the top, you have your hours and minutes that you can write in there, and you can use this every 10 minutes, every 15 minutes, or every hour if you so choose. And you can just write that in there with the hour on top and the minutes right underneath it. Along the left side, you're going to see a bunch of little symbols, so you can go ahead and trend glucose, you can trend systolic or diastolic blood pressure. You can put your MAP in there, your mean arterial pressure. You should track your temperatures, your SpO2s. You can track your pulse rate, your end-tidal CO2 if you have it, and your respirations. And you don't have to use all those things, but whatever you use, it's going to be really easy, and I'll show you why in a minute. Now, as you go down on the left side, you see urine output, because that's one of the most important things you can monitor if you do it correctly. You're going to have your GCS on your unconscious patients, or your pain scale on your more patient conscious patients. You can put your fluids in and whatever drip rate you have going on. And then you have your little GCS score right there, in case you forget how to calculate that. Along the very bottom are some of the drugs that you can put in there. So if you're giving a guy ketamine or you're giving a guy Versed, you can put the dose and the time you gave it, and then watch how his vitals trend right above it. On the very far right side, we have a checklist of all the nursing care interventions that we recommend. It's not all inclusive, and if you want to change any of these, you can go ahead and download this thing, and it's fully customizable, so you can put whatever else in there that you want. If you have these printed out, into large versions in your aid station or med room. Everybody can see what's going on at all times. We got these printed out at the Vios on our post. That's where you get your DA photo. They usually have some kind of AV shop with these giant printers. If you don't have access to that, maybe you can go down to your S2 or your map section and have them print something out for you. You don't need these things to be 3x2 like we have here. If you have it just double size, if you had to print it out on two sheets of paper and tape them together and put some laminate, it's really going to be better than just one small sheet of paper. So here we have another nursing care brain, and as you can see, there are numbers all over the place, and you don't really know what's going on with that patient unless you focus in and look at those numbers. It's pretty hard to read. It depends on the person's handwriting, and somebody coming up behind them may or may not be able to read very important information on that patient. So what we want to do is get you guys to start trending your vitals, and here's how you're going to do that. All right, if you're manually trending your vitals, stand back and look at what's going on with your patient. And you guys should be learning this in Trauma 3 or ATM. You can stand back and manage your team. Make sure that you can see the flow sheets and the trends and the vitals, and you can see if it matches their clinical appearance. You can anticipate what's going on and devise a plan. And by that, I mean, you can see if your heart rate's starting to go up and your blood pressure's starting to go down, maybe this guy has some bleeding that's not controlled somewhere. You can make a plan for that. And this is what I'm talking about. Boom, his heart rate's going up. His blood pressure's going down overall. You put in a Foley at the very bottom there and you start seeing some urine outputs. If you notice something like this is going on and you're not sure what's going on with your patient, go ahead and call somebody. You know, get on the radio, get on your sat phone, and try to get some advice. You want to do this early so that later on when there are emergencies going on, you already have a plan for that patient. If you don't know what to say, we have a little call script available. This is the COMO cheat sheet or call script. You can go ahead and write in your PACE plan for who you're going to call and the phone numbers associated with that. You can put in the little fill in the blanks, what's going on with your patients. And then at the very bottom, we have recommendations from that call. So you can prompt the guy, hey, do I need to give this guy any different fluids or meds? Should I change my interventions or procedures that I'm doing? What are some red flags that I should look for on this type of patient? Once you identify the thresholds or the red flags that we just talked about, go ahead and mark them on the chart. So if you notice, you have this guy, his heart rate's going up, and you say the red flag is going to be, hey, his heart rate gets above 120, and he starts having some lower urine output, he's getting hypovolemic, I can go ahead and start the fresh whole blood. And as you administer that fresh whole blood, maybe his heart rate's still going up, but by the time it's in the patient, his heart rate's going down instead of just crashing. All right, you're gonna go ahead and wanna prepare your equipment and checklist for your intervention. So if you're doing a fresh whole blood transfusion non-emergently, make sure that you just go through everything with your team, make sure everybody knows what they're going to be doing and what you need. If you're going to be going ahead and doing something like an awake crike, make sure that you have your checklist ready and everything on that checklist is near the patient and ready to go. Brief your team, your non-medical guys, on what to expect. Say, hey, I'm going to cut this guy's neck. You know, there might be a little bit of blood. It's going to be okay. I'm going to put the tube in and we're going to check placement. This is how we're going to do it. This is the time, if you have a junior medic or you have a telemedicine consult, to ask for other ideas. You know, you don't want to get into the emergent situation or you start doing your intervention and somebody brings up the good idea fairy. And now you guys are arguing what to do and now the patient's becoming more emergent. You know, figure out your plan and then stick to it. So once it's time to act, it's time to act. Everybody should be on the same page. You've already briefed them what to expect. And this is all from trending those vital signs. This is how easy these procedures can be. So if you're using electronic monitors, you got your Philips MP2 or your Welch Allyn, your little three lead hooked up to your patient, make sure that you continue to mark that for everyone to see. Just because that patient's vitals are normal right now, they may be out of whack from the baseline that you took 3 hours ago. And if you're just watching what's going on that monitor, you're just getting a snapshot in time and you're not trending per se. So whatever that monitor says, you still should be taking those vitals every 15 minutes, every hour, depending on what your patient's doing. And that's a call that you're going to make. So here's some of the adjuncts that you can use to monitor. You got your little pulse ox, you got your capnometer, you got your Welch Allyn. Maybe you got your Philips or a Tempus, and then in the future, perhaps you'll have them on your smartphone. So now we're going to go over how you basically define what you're going to be doing for your patient. You're going to list out your problems and then your plans, and then you can use it as a checklist. This is something that Justin showed me through his 6-page documentation, and I have it laminated and it's in my aid bag, and it's a great way to go ahead and organize your thoughts. So you're going to identify the injuries, and for each one of those injuries, make a plan that you're going to do immediately, and then possibly one that you're going to do as a little more long term. So as you can see, you have this guy. He's a multi-systems trauma patient. He's got a facial lack. You put in a crike. He's got sucking chest wound, a lack to his arm, and an inguinal bleed, or a tourniquet on his leg there. So what you can do is you can list out each problem: the facial lack, the crike because it's an open wound, gunshot wound to the left chest, shrapnel to the left arm, tourniquet on the left leg, exit wound on his left back. So you made sure that you went through this whole patient, you didn't miss everything, everything's written out, and now you can start to plan for each one of those things. Make sure that you mark something like tourniquet on his leg that you convert to pressure dressing so that you understand to do that later. So if you're just working straight down the checklist, you don't get to, oh, I need to convert tourniquet. Uh-oh, it's already 7 hours into it. And I'll show you at the end how you can put that plan into action and prioritize a little bit better. So here's another way that you can trend your vital signs. It's just another chart. It's a real simple one, but it keeps you apprised of all the important information like blood pressure, heart rate, respirations, and end-tidal CO2 if it's available. Here are some of those reminders out of the SOFMED handbook, and it's something that you could possibly go ahead and circle if it's something important to do, or you could cross it off if it's something you don't need to do. You should be trending the Glasgow Coma Scale, and if you want to do it every couple of hours, you can go ahead and do it right here, and here's something that you can put on the wall of your aid station. This is still part of that 6-page patient care flow sheet. And there we have the script that we just stuck under there because there was some white space and the recommendations from that telemed call right there on the right side. All right, if you're going to implement a treatment or a care plan, you're going to want to share that with everybody that's working with you, especially, like I said before, the non-medical or medically trained guys. You're going to want to share your mental model or your vision for the patient and your expectations so that everybody is on the same page and working toward the same goals. So you have your problem list here on the left side, and you can go ahead and start prioritizing your procedures here on the right side. And then you have your check mark boxes, and you can just start working down. So now you're converting your tourniquet to a pressure dressing first, then you're getting to your occlusive dressings, monitoring for tension. So now you can really step back from the patient and start writing these things down, and it should help you organize your thoughts much better than other ways that you've done this before. Here it is all laminated out. If you had a patient with no walls, you're out in the middle of nowhere, you're just doing this next to a vehicle with a litter and some litter stands. Right there, you've got it hooked up to next to the litter so everybody can see it and everybody knows which patient it goes to if you have multiple patients. There's another way to laminate it, and it's on our wall here at our prolonged field care lab. All right, here's the flow sheet that the GermanSoft gave to us, and I really like that they have on the bottom right there, they have their MassCal triage category. So you can circle or X out or whatever you guys have your SOP as, and you can easily identify what patient is what category. And this is the back side of their sheet, both things you can download from this presentation from prolongfieldcare.org. All right, now we're going to get into some of the specialty flow sheets and checklists. The JTTS Clinical Practice Guideline Burn Patient Appendix A is a 5-page nursing care checklist that you fill in the blanks and you can distribute or put next to that patient, and everybody can read through it if they have a 2 or 3 hour shift watching that patient. Then you can do the Burn Patient Appendix B flow sheet. We'll get into all of these in a little more detail. We also have the MACE TBI neuro exam card that everybody should be using on neuro patients or head injured patients. And then we have the SORT nursing care checklist, which is a really great 1-page checklist for nursing care and prolonged field care. And then at the end, I'll show you a quick little multiple or mass casualty checklist to help you stay organized in a terrible situation. So here is the 5-page nursing care checklist. Like I said, it's on prolongfieldcare.org. These are just the first 2 pages, and it's a really great resource, so I highly recommend that you download it and probably have this in hard copy somewhere, maybe your PFC binder, like I have in my Pelican box. So here's your 72-hour fluid admin flow sheet. It's based off the AISR rule of tens, and it's going to get you through a burn care patient as far as how much fluids you're giving him compared to the urine output. This MACE exam, well, I think it's 8 pages, yeah. So you can download all 8 pages. If you just download it to your smartphone, you can go ahead and go through it. But if you have it hard copy, like I said before, with all the other downloads, it's going to be real easy to just pull it out and do it. And this is something that you can give initially, soon after a blast or head injury, and then within 24 hours you can do another, and then 48 hours you could do another. And you can kind of trend the patient's neuro status a little more closely than the GCS score. This is the SORT prolonged field care checklist. This is all the nursing care that you need to know about, and it kind of gives you some recommendations there on the left side of timelines and when you should do what. All right, we also have the ketamine drip flow sheet. This should be what you guys are using for TEVA in the schoolhouse, and it really helps you keep track of the doses and flow rates and drip rates of everything that you're giving your patient. And if you compare that to your vitals, then you can go ahead and make adjustments accordingly. Once you get into more than one patient, in a mass cal situation, you're still going to want to track what's going on with each one. Maybe you don't have time to do a full trending vital sign chart. So you can download something like this. This is right off the internet, and this is something that nurses would use if they have, 5 patients in their unit. So this is something that I would use, and I have available in my mass cal kit. On the front side are 22 patients, on the back side are 22 patients. That's 44 total. Hopefully you never have to deal with that many patients, but if you do, it's going to help you organize what's going on with each one of those and where they're going and their evac categories. So it's something that I wish I would have had when I was doing all the stuff during Hurricane Katrina, and that's why I came up with this one right here. So I hope you've learned all these things, and I hope it improves the way that you give medical care to your patients. We'd like to thank you for listening, and please send any questions or comments to the associated blog post on prolongfieldcare.org.